So we're going to have actually just a Q&A, which about all of the topics that we talked about. I already have a whole bunch, a slew of questions, so I'll ask that. I'll sit down, actually, with you guys. So just to remind you, Dr. Jiun Do is there from UC San Diego, Dr. Ava Bittner, and then myself. I'll just sit down so we can have like a nice, easy chat, and then I'll take my notes with me. Okay, my first question actually is going to be for you have a lot of questions, okay, I'm just going to tell you this right now. It's mostly about the clinical trials. People are interested in getting access to clinical trials. Do you have trials at your center? How does one get involved?
So we do have clinical trials. I will say the stem cell clinical trials, though, no one really is conducting those at the moment. So you want to be very cautious about anyone currently advertising clinical stem cell trials for treatment of any blindness. We do clinical trials at UCSD. You know, we are looking at ways of diagnosing glaucoma, ways of treating glaucoma, and we do enroll patients. And so to get involved, you know, I think there is a website called clinicaltrials.gov. So if you're researching or someone is talking about a clinical trials, make sure you go to clinicaltrials.gov, take a look, see who's involved, what institutions are involved, what individuals, what they're looking at, and if you qualify. But I think more importantly, talk to your glaucoma specialist about it as well. You know, there are very strict criteria for certain trials. We also want to make sure you're being taken care of and you're safe. And I think that's the primary, you know, that's number one. And then the next one there is obviously finding something that works for you. And so the clinical trials are there, but please consult with your glaucoma specialist and also look on that website, clinicaltrials.gov. Make sure that the trials being run are rigorous and that they are safe.
That's a really great and important point. You as physicians, I mean, as patients, may not necessarily know what the safe trials are. You won't know, actually, I'll tell you that, right? Because any person in the country can come up with a clinical trial and put it into the website. And there have been reports of clinical trials that were not very well done. Let's just leave it at that. And so you should consult. And because we in the field know who the reputable people are in that particular field, so we can do that. I think that's really, really key. There are a couple of questions on how patients can help further this to make stem cell treatment a reality. That's always, I mean, at least once a week I'm asked about stem cell treatment. So are there anything patients can do?
So definitely. I think, you know, we're still learning about glaucoma as well, the different causes of it. Dr. Bedrood mentioned there are genetic causes for it, so there's testing. People are collecting the genetic data from patients who have glaucoma, and we're learning, we're putting that all together, because we say glaucoma, but glaucoma is a really big entity, and there are multiple causes for glaucoma, and we really need to figure out which glaucoma certain people have so that we're able to treat it appropriately. So definitely, I think, you know, getting involved is, a lot of times we as glaucoma specialists, we have a lot of conferences. We are very up to date about what people are doing, who might be interested in a certain type of glaucoma. And so I think, again, your glaucoma specialist would be a great source. Helping in terms of the stem cell research, I think, you know, I have to give a shout out again to the Glaucoma Research Foundation. Would not be here without it, but, you know, finding these people who have a shared vision, shared goal, it is, you know, it's inspiring to be able to work with individuals who have that goal in mind, and you really do find motivation from that. So getting in touch with the foundations such as this, the GRF, and really being involved, that can really, I think, move things forward, because we have a lot of innovative physician scientists looking to get started, but the work and the research is intensive, and it takes a lot of resources, and, you know, they have a lot of promise, and I think we should support them.
Okay, I am going to come back to you with some things, give you a little break, okay, Dr. Bittner. What, in regards to low vision, do I need a doctor's referral to see a low vision specialist?
You do not. So we can see anyone who's having visual difficulty with any activities or tasks. And so the first question I always ask of people when they're new to vision rehabilitation is, what kind of things that you need to do or want to do during the day, your usual activities, are giving you difficulty because of your vision? So be prepared to answer questions like that. And you know, we always start off with a refraction of making sure you're up to date as far as any glasses and correction that you may need there. Again, we can do quite a bit with giving a stronger prescription for near. Often that can be helpful to help with difficulty up close. You know, sometimes, you know, the doctors, they don't always refer, so it's helpful for me as a vision rehab provider to get copies of your exam records from your ophthalmologist or optometrist, and so I tend to request those, just so going into the exam, I have all that information about your eyes and your vision and your condition, and then we can just focus on how your vision impairment is affecting, you know, the activities and things that you want to be able to do and enjoy.
Okay, without getting, you know, into a whole low vision, because this takes a long, those are timely
they
exams.
They are. So the first, a new low vision patient exam with me, they're scheduled for a whole hour. And then, as you saw during my talk, we can do a lot more with follow-ups and training and devices. But even at that first visit, after you see me or one of the optometrists, you'll work with our staff or our technicians to explore and learn, demo some of the new devices. And so it is quite extensive. You're not going to be waiting around, but plan to spend a few hours really getting into using different devices and seeing what's appropriate for you and, you know, what might be helpful.
Is there a type of vision or like a cutoff of vision that you see or?
No, we take it all. And so actually the practice guidelines from the American Academy of Ophthalmology say there is no defining level of visual impairment. So really any kind of visual difficulty would be appropriate to come and see us for vision rehabilitation.
Right. I think the misnomer is that some people think it's for completely blind patients and that's the only person that can go in there, but it is not. I mean, you can have central vision remaining. You could not have central. I mean, it could be for all varieties. Maybe someone who has early glaucoma and has difficulty with contrast sensitivity only. That's important, and I think that's something, again, I will continue to say how important the low vision clinics are for that. Any tips for driving in difficult lighting conditions like bright sun, fog, dusk, or night? Any glasses that would help with that?
Yeah, I didn't touch on it during my talk, but we do quite a bit with filters for both daytime and or nighttime. There are some as well. And we have a wide selection. We have one of my staff or technician will go outside and allow patients to try on all different types of filters, and some cut off different wavelengths, or their different colors, or how dark or how tinted they are varies, and everyone is very individual as to what works best for them. So we usually go outside. We're fortunate here. Most days are sunny, and so we can evaluate what's the best filter for that individual. And often there are filters that have good wraparound or protection from the sides and the top, and those are helpful. So for glare, some are also for indoor glare. Some people are sensitive to fluorescent lights indoors, so we do quite a bit with filters. I just didn't have it in my slide deck because of time, and we don't have as much research, but it's just a personal preference for everyone. But filters we do quite a bit with.
And are there, other than UCLA, because it can be a little hard to navigate UCLA, are there other low vision clinics in Southern California that you can just name off a few?
Sure. There are people in private practice. I know someone in Santa Monica I collaborate with. There are also colleges of optometry, and they all have a vision rehabilitation center. So Southern California College of Optometry in Marshall B. Ketchum, or at Western University, And so you can just search for low vision or vision rehabilitation. You'll find local providers, and they're working to establish databases, but
okay,
yeah.
Great, so. Thank you. Okay, I'm gonna go back to a question from the audience regarding stem cells. Dr. Do talked about stem cells for regeneration of retinal ganglion cell layer, but what about the nerve growth factor, which has already been formulated for neurotrophic keratopathy, and they even, whoever said this, even cited the pharmaceutical, Dompé. Dompé has a drop called Oxervate, and Oxervate is a very intensive drop. We actually use it in our patients because we have a lot of corneal patients with neurotrophic keratopathy, and that drop goes on the eye, and it's supposed to regenerate the epithelium of corneal patients. So that's the neurotrophic corneal part, which is a totally different part than the back. Can this NGF be formulated to apply to glaucoma patients based on what you think?
Yeah, so the neurotrophic factors, or NGF, it's actually a big class of proteins, and so there are multiple types of neural growth factors. And there are some studies, NGF in particular itself hasn't been looked at, or it has been studied in glaucoma experimental models, but really the one that's the closest right now is something called ciliary trophic neurotrophic factors, or CNTF. There are some clinical trials now done by Jeff Goldberg, who are looking at how this medication or this protein might be able to protect retinal ganglion cells. So definitely we are looking into that. It also speaks to the need to tailor really treatments of glaucoma for those with early disease, where we can actually protect those retinal ganglion cells with these neurotrophic factors. I think it's a great idea. I think it shows promise. We just may have to find the right combination that's still in the works. And then on the other spectrum of things with stem cells, to be able to replace them. And stem cells themselves, there's actually something called exosomes, where they release some protective factors as well that can sometimes help protect the retinal ganglion cells. And so I think we have people who are also studying those things.
Great. And then how long, I think you may have mentioned this, how long do you envision stem cell treatment for glaucoma?
Yeah, I think with stem cell treatments, probably in terms of the replacement, decades, I would say. I think within our lifetime, we'll probably see something there. With something earlier on, like the neurotrophic factors or the neuroprotection, I think we're getting even closer to those. So within a decade, probably we will see something for that. But you know, there's a spectrum and a gradient with the replacement. I think that will be one of the first ones with a neural stem cell relay. That may take a little bit more time, but I'm hoping we'll be able to offer that to people.
Okay, good. And then in the last minute or two that we have left before lunch, there are a bunch of questions about low vision, if you don't mind me asking you. One is, are low vision evaluations covered by Medicare or other healthcare insurance companies?
They are. The evaluation is covered, and it's the devices, if you elect to purchase a magnifier and such. Those are not covered. But the actual exam, the evaluation, having the opportunity to demo and trial the devices and receive training for them, all of that is covered.
And then, Dr. Bittner, does your team help with career development or opportunities for low vision patients? I'm not quite sure what the question means, but maybe they're saying beyond just visual capabilities, is there like support groups, or I don't know, like I think that's what this question's about, but any career development or opportunities for those patients?
Yeah, so when I think of vocational needs, we'll consider what you need as far as your work to be successful, whether it's computer or other, you know, whatever tasks you have for work. So we do focus it on what those needs are. We also can refer and help coordinate with the Division of Rehab Services. Many states have one, we do here in California. And they can help people who are working aged they will get devices if you're needing them for work or educational purposes. So for younger individuals, we help coordinate with them as well.
Okay, well, very good. I think this wraps up our session for Q&A.